How to Build a Dinosaur. Extinction Doesn't Have to Be Forever. By Jack Horner and James Gorman. Narrated by Patrick Lawlor. Copyright 2009 by Jack Horner and James Gorman. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Dutton Books, a member of Penguin Group USA Incorporated, and was produced in the year 2009 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Introduction. Nothing is too wonderful to be true if it be consistent with the laws of nature, and in such things as these, experiment is the best test of such consistency. Michael Faraday. Let's suppose you want to pick a moment in the fossil record of particular interest and play it over again, backwards and forwards, like a football play on a highlights DVD, so you could see exactly how it happened. Rewind, stop, play. Rewind frame by frame, stop, play frame by frame. Stephen Jay Gould, one of the best-known evolutionary biologists of his time, wrote in Wonderful Life, his book on the weird and wonderful fossils of a rock formation known as the Burgess Shale, that you can't go home again evolutionarily unless you want to risk not being here when you come back. What he was saying was that evolution is a chance business, contingent on many influences and events. You can't rewind it and run it over and hope to get the same result. The second time through, Homo sapiens might not appear. Primates might not appear. That's evolution on a grand scale. Major trends in the history of life that involved mass extinctions and numerous species jockeying for evolutionary position. We can't rewind that tape without a planet to toy with. But I'm thinking about a time machine with a somewhat closer focus, an evolutionary microscope that could target, say, the first appearance of feathers on dinosaurs, or the evolution of dinosaurs into birds. This time machine/microscope could zero in on one body part. For birds, we might start small, with a much maligned body part, the tail. We don't think about tails much, not at the high levels of modern evolutionary biology, but they are more intriguing than you might imagine. They appear and disappear in evolution. They appear and disappear in the growth of a tadpole. Most primates have tails. Humans and great apes are exceptions. The dinosaurs had tails, some quite remarkable. Birds, the descendants of dinosaurs, now almost universally described by scientists as avian dinosaurs, do not have tails. They have tail feathers, but not an extended muscular tail complete with vertebrae and nerves. Some of the first birds had tails, long tails, and some later birds had short tails. But there is no modern bird with a tail. How did that change occur? Is there a way to recreate that evolutionary change and see how it happened, right down to the molecules involved in directing or stopping tail growth? I think the answer is yes. I think we can rewind the tape of bird evolution to the point before feathers or a tail emerged or teeth disappeared. Then we can watch it run forward and then rewind again and try to play it without the evolutionary change, reverting to the original process. I'm not suggesting we can do this on a grand scale, but we can pick a species, study its growth as an embryo, learn how it develops, and learn how to change that development. Then we can experiment with individual embryos, intervening in development in different ways, with no change, with one change, or several changes. This would be a bit like rerunning Game 6 of the 1986 World Series between the New York Mets and the Boston Red Sox, when a ground ball ran between first baseman Billy Buckner's legs and changed the tide of the series. We would be doing more than just fiddling with the tape. We would be redoing the play with Billy Buckner and all the players. And the idea would be to determine the precise cause of the Mets' joy and Red Sox sadness. Was it Buckner's failing legs, the speed of the ball, The topography of the field? What caused him to miss the ball? And when we think we know the cause, we test our hypothesis. We give him younger legs or smooth out the field, and then we see if, in this altered set of circumstances, he snags the grounder. That's impossible to do in baseball. We don't have a way to go back in time. We can do it with computer models, of course, in both baseball and biology. But with current technology and our current understanding of development and evolution, we could also do it with a living organism. This ability is largely the result of a new and thriving field of research that has joined together the study of how an embryo develops with the study of how evolution occurs. The idea, in simple terms, is that because the shape or form of an animal emerges as it grows from a fertilized egg to hatching or birth, any evolutionary change in that shape must be reflected in a change in the way the embryo grows. For example, in a long-tailed ancient bird embryo, the tail would have started to develop and continued to develop until the chick hatched with a full tail. The embryos of descendant species, which hatched with no tails, would have to develop in a different way. We can observe the embryos of modern birds as they develop, and if we can pinpoint the moment at which the tail stops growing, and we can figure out exactly what events occurred at the molecular level to stop tail growth, we can say that's where the change occurred in evolution. And that's an idea we can test. We can try intervening at that moment in the embryo's growth to change the growth and development signals back to what we believe they were before the tail disappeared in evolution. If we are right, then the long tail should grow. If we can do this with a tail, we ought to be able to do it with teeth, feathers, wings, and feet. The most studied and most available bird for both laboratory and culinary experiments is the chicken. Why couldn't we take a chicken embryo and biochemically nudge it this way and that until what hatched was not a chicken, but a small dinosaur with teeth, forearms with claws, and a tail? No reason at all. We haven't done it yet, but we are taking the first small steps. And this book is about those steps, the path ahead, what we could learn, and why we should try, from a scientific and ethical point of view. This may sound like something that belongs in a movie. It seems very remote from my specialty, vertebrate paleontology, in particular the study of dinosaurs. Paleontologists, after all, are the slightly eccentric folks who dig up old bones in sun-drenched badlands and like to talk too much about skulls and femurs. Well, that may be true as far as it goes, but that's only part of the story. At heart, every paleontologist is as much Frank Buck as Stephen Jay Gould. Frank Buck was a real person who became a hero of movies and books before and after World War II. He went into the jungles and remote places of the world and brought back not fossils, but exotic, living animals. He was, and this appealed to many a small boy, not a hunter who killed his prey, but a collector of live animals. And his motto, once as well known as any of today's catchphrases, was, "Bring 'em back alive." Well, paleontologists may deal with the long dead, but at the heart of all the digging and preparation of skeletons and museum displays is the attempt to reconstruct the past, to recreate moments in the history of life. What we would really love to do if we could is bring 'em back alive. That hasn't really been possible for the past two centuries, as dinosaur scientists have ventured far into the past, into what is often called deep time, millions and millions of years ago, retrieving clues and broken pieces of a puzzle that we then try to solve. Sometimes it's a literal puzzle, with pieces of fossil skeletons that must be connected and made to fit. Sometimes it's a puzzle at another level, trying to put together a long-gone ecological system. Sometimes it is macroscopic, writing the story of the great trends of evolution from the seas to land, from the land to the air, from reptile to bird. Sometimes it is microscopic, digging deep into the tissue of ancient bones to tease out the physiology of dinosaurs or the molecular makeup of fossilized tissue. We describe what dinosaurs were like and present these ideas in scientific papers and books. We build skeletons and sculptures of dinosaurs that any museum goer can appreciate. We have made robotic dinosaurs for education and entertainment. We have even helped make movies hew more closely to the scientific facts. So it's a natural enough step to go from building a dinosaur to growing one, from the mechanical to the biological. Or so it seemed, and seems to me, which is how I became an instigator and a recruiter, looking for scientists with more expertise in the molecular biology lab to pursue what may seem at first like a cockeyed idea, to make the ultimate reconstruction of the past, a living dinosaur. The first part of any reconstruction is to understand just what it is you are trying to construct. If you're going to indulge in biological reverse engineering, you have to take your target creature apart to see how it works. That's the bread and butter of dinosaur scientists. We find fossils, dig them up, date them, put them in a context with other organisms that lived during their time. We use the fossilized bones to establish the shape of the dinosaur. We make educated guesses, some more solid than others, about movement, behavior, social life, parental involvement with the young. With modern imaging technologies and computing power, we look deeper than ever before into the fossils we find. We can see inside the bones. We use CT scans and MRIs to make 3D images of the inside of skulls. We smash up bits of fossils to search for preserved remnants of muscle tissue, blood vessels, red blood cells. We use the tools of chemistry and physics to go deeper yet. The technological changes in how bones are studied are profound. For most of the last century, the study of dinosaurs has been primarily a collector's game. It has certainly not been an experimental science, but that is changing. We can now retrieve ancient biomolecules, like proteins, from fossils tens of millions of years old. And we can mine the genomes of living creatures to trace evolutionary history. We can bring the history of life into the laboratory to test our ideas with experiments. And right at the top of the list of the experiments we can try is the attempt to bring back the characteristics of extinct creatures that have long been lost to us in deep time. That is how we can build a dinosaur. We may someday recover bits of dinosaur DNA, but that is not the route to making a dinosaur. That has already been tried in the movies, but it won't happen in real life. I'm not putting down the movies. I loved Jurassic Park, not least because I worked on it and the sequels as a technical consultant to help get the dinosaurs right. And the idea of cloning a dinosaur from DNA recovered from a mosquito preserved in amber that once fed on dinosaurs was a brilliant fiction. It was, however, a fiction that reflected the science of its time. The fascination with DNA and the idea that we would have a complete blueprint of a dinosaur to make one. Now we are actually much closer to being able to create a dinosaur without needing to recover ancient DNA. We can do it because of the nature of evolution and the way it builds on itself, adapting old plans to new circumstances, not inventing new life forms from scratch. Much of the writing about dinosaurs in recent times has concentrated on the way we have been correcting our old mistakes. But mistakes are to be expected when you are trying to reach back tens of millions of years. What is amazing, if you stop to think about it, is that we got the main points right about their shape and structure right off the bat. How could we do that so easily when you might think that such ancient animals could have taken any shape imaginable, or unimaginable. The answer is that evolution does not allow innovation without limit. It did not allow the dinosaurs to pop up in any old shape. They have the same body plan that all other animals with backbones do. Anyone can see that immediately, with or without science. Anyone who has seen a deer skeleton, or a lizard skeleton, or a human skeleton would recognize the basics in a bunch of T-Rex bones dug from the ground. T-Rex has a spine, a skull, ribs, just as an eel or a salmon or a mouse does. It has hind limbs and forelimbs, just as crocodiles and frogs, hawks and people do. Why? Why do animals of such different external shapes and lives share characteristics so similar that we can immediately recognize the basics of their bone structure? The reason is that shape is not an unlimited smorgasbord from which evolution can pick and choose. All living things are part of a continuum. The shapes of animals evolve over time from earlier ancestral shapes. Different groups of animals have basic body plans that themselves evolved from earlier plans. All vertebrates have backbones. But before that innovation, they evolved from creatures that all had a front-to-back orientation for eating and elimination. Before that came self-propulsion. Before that, energy metabolism. And so on back to DNA itself, which we share with all living things, unless RNA viruses count as living things. A body plan is an abstract idea. Four limbs, spine, skull, mouth at the front, elimination at the other end. But it has remained constant and resilient. Mountains have risen and fallen, seas have appeared and dried up, and continents themselves have shifted, while the standard four-limb plan, the tetrapod blueprint, has persisted with minor modifications. The bones in the hands and arms used to type these words are almost the same as the bones in buffalo chicken wings. If you follow the development of a chicken embryo closely, you will see five buds at the end of the developing wing, buds that also appear in the embryos of mice and people. The buds become fingers in a human embryo and claws in a mouse. In a chicken, the five buds on a forelimb will lengthen, shorten, disappear, and be fused to fit into the familiar structure that cries out to us for hot sauce. The record of such astonishing and persistent continuity of form has been described as the main gift the fossil record has given to evolutionary biology. Evolutionary change is added to existing plans. Genetic blueprints are not thrown out. We don't have to start from scratch to grow a dinosaur. We don't have to retrieve ancient DNA for cloning. Birds are descended from dinosaurs. They are dinosaurs, and most of the genetic program for the dinosaur characteristics we want to bring back should still be available in birds, in fact, in the chicken. You can see evidence of this continuity in the way an embryo develops, and chicken embryos, in those perfectly functional containers, hard-shelled eggs, have been endlessly studied. Aristotle was the first to record the stages of growth of a chicken embryo. Other scientists have followed in Aristotle's footsteps, partly because chickens and chicken eggs are so available. You can see easily and clearly with a low-power dissecting microscope that a tail like a dinosaur's is well on its way in the growing chicken embryo before something stops it. The result is a plump tail stump called the Pope's or Parson's nose, if your specialty is eating chickens, or the pygostyle, if you are more given to studying them. The pygostyle is a hodgepodge of different bones, the growth and purpose of which have been redirected, just the kind of jumble that evolution specializes in. It is a perfect demonstration that evolution does not suggest intelligence, planning, or purpose, but rather accident and opportunism. Evolution is, by definition, not revolution. It works within the system, using what it finds. One of the hottest fields in science now is evo-devo, for evolutionary developmental biology. It has also been called devo-evo, or DE, for developmental evolution. Whatever the name, it is the investigation of how evolution proceeds through changes in the growth of embryos. The limb-to-wing transition does not require a complete new set of genes, but rather changes in the control of a few genes that promote or stop growth. These genes produce chemicals called growth and signaling factors that give directions to the cells in a growing embryo. When they are turned on or off at different times, they can drastically change the shape of an animal. It's a bit like remixing an old recording. Let's take a band with a banjo, guitar, and a mandolin playing She'll Be Coming Round the Mountain. The original recording features the banjo, but you want just the guitar and mandolin, so you turn the banjo tracks way down. If you look at it this way, a bird is just a new arrangement of an old tune. The dinosaur symphony and the old genetic information are in there, but the sound is more contemporary. Of course, the better tune right here might be the old standard, the chicken song. C-H-I-C-K-E-N, that is the way to spell chicken. I have a chicken skeleton on my desk at the Museum of the Rockies. I have kept a chicken skeleton at hand wherever I have worked for decades, because it looks like a dinosaur, and I like being around dinosaur skeletons. Sometimes I look at it and turn it this way and that and think, if I could just grow these bones a little different, tilt this one way, that another, I'd have a dinosaur skeleton. Over the past few years, I started looking at that chicken skeleton more often and more intensely. As I looked at the bones, I started thinking less about the bones and more about the underlying molecular processes that caused the bones to grow. And the more I learned about evo-devo and looked at that chicken skeleton, the more reasonable an idea it seemed. That skeleton started out as an embryo, a single cell, dividing and growing, the cells differentiating into different types. Chemical signals directed by DNA turned it away from the path of growth that would lead to a non-avian dinosaur. But it seemed highly likely that all the raw material, all the genetic information needed to grow a dinosaur, was in that embryo. How much, I wondered, would it take to redirect its growth so that it ended up looking like a dinosaur? Experimentalists have already caused a chicken to grow teeth. Other researchers have chemically nudged chicken embryos to develop the different sorts of beaks that the famous Darwin's finches display. Once I got the idea in my head that it could be done, I started talking to researchers who were truly grounded and fluent in the language, ideas, and techniques of both paleontology and molecular biology, like Hans Larsson at McGill. He was already working on what he called experimental atavisms as a way of understanding evolution. That is, he wanted to prompt a living creature to develop an ancestral trait. The short version of the story is that I recruited Hans to drive the chicken-slash-dinosaur express, at least part of the way. Hans is not growing a dinosaur, not yet, and none of the embryos in his experiments will hatch. But his research and my waking dream of having a chicken-sized dinosaur with teeth, a tail, and forelimbs instead of wings fit well together. So I supported research on the tail, on getting that chicken embryo to express its inner tail. He has already discovered aspects of tail growth that tie this process to the very basic and early directions for growth of any vertebrate, including humans. So the work may have unexpected value for some of the most common and awful birth defects, those affecting the early growth of the spinal cord. The finch researchers showed how beaks could be modified by a change in one gene. If successful, Hans will show how the dinosaur's tail turned into the chicken's pygostyle, and how to grow a chicken with a tail instead of a pygostyle. He will also have laid the groundwork for future work and, perhaps, for finally hatching that living example of how evolution works. The scientific rewards of the process of learning how to rewind evolution would be enormous. It would be a remarkable demonstration of a direct link between molecular changes in the developmental process and large evolutionary changes in the shape of animal bodies. We know quite a lot about the evolution of different forms from the fossil record, and we also know about specific changes in DNA that cause identifiable changes in body shape in the laboratory, in fruit flies in particular. But we are just now beginning to link molecular changes to large changes in the history of life, like the loss of a tail. I don't know yet whether we will finally hatch the dinosaur I imagine from a chicken egg. This is a scientific adventure, and the book is about how that adventure came about, how I and other scientists have tried in every way to travel into the past and bring it to life, how we began with pick and shovel, moved to CT scans and mass spectrometers, and have now arrived at the embryology lab. The story starts with old-fashioned fossil hunting, with the hunt, the discovery, and the digging, always digging. There are two excavations here, both of the same Tyrannosaurus rex skeleton, a treasure of a find nicknamed B-Rex, taken from the fierce badlands of eastern Montana. The story continues with a second, microscopic excavation of the fossil bone itself by Mary Schweitzer, and the discovery of 68-million-year-old blood vessels, still flexible, and partly fossilized red blood cells and bone cells and protein molecules. There comes a point, however, in studying dinosaurs and in this story, when fossil bones can yield no more. The search for more information about how dinosaurs evolved has to shift to the genes of living creatures. That is where the story takes a sharp turn, like the one the chicken's growing tail makes as it stops growing and turns into something else. And there it chronicles how and why we know that the history of evolution is written in the genes of modern dinosaurs, the birds, and how and why we can take a chicken egg that might have become part of an omelet or an egg McMuffin and convince it to turn into the kind of dinosaur we all recognize. If we succeed, it will be another step in a long chain of attempts to recreate the past. The first public exhibition of dinosaurs was in England in 1854 at the Crystal Palace in Sydenham, 5 years before Darwin published his Origin of Species. It was groundbreaking, although the stances of the animals were wrong, putting dinosaurs that stood on their hind legs on all fours instead. Over time, our reconstructions of dinosaurs have become more sophisticated and more correct. We have changed the stances of dinosaurs in museums, learned that many of them were warm-blooded, that dinosaurs, not birds, were the first to have feathers, that some dinosaurs lived in colonies and cared for their young in nests, that many of them were much smarter and more agile than we ever imagined. We have made accurate robots and 3D reconstructions of the internal cavities of skulls. We have theorized about the colors and sounds and behavior of dinosaurs. And now we can try to make a living dinosaur. This is a project that will outrage some people as a sacrilegious attempt to interfere with life and be scoffed at by others as impossible, and others as more showmanship than science. I don't answer any of these questions, really, because the answers are not mine to provide. I have my ideas, my concerns, my own questions about the value and difficulties of such a project. But the story I have to tell is, like science itself, more about questions than answers, and the book is not a recipe or lecture. If we get to the point of hatching a dinosaur, that would be a decision that involves society as a whole, not a few scientists in a laboratory. Most of all, this book is an invitation to an adventure. I can say how it begins, but all of us will have a say in how it ends. Chapter 1. Hell Creek. Scientific people, proceeded the time traveler after the pause required for proper assimilation of this, know very well that time is only a kind of space. H.G. Wells, The Time Machine. To get to Hell Creek, you drive east from Bozeman and back in time. Bozeman is firmly located in the present. 25 years ago, it was a sleepy college town where you could stop into a video poker bar and play pool while the Montana State University rodeo team celebrated at a nearby table. The town had coffee shops and college burger joints and creeping vegetarianism, but styles still lagged behind the coasts. Things have changed. In 1980, Bozeman had a little more than 20,000 people. Now it has 33,000. The nearby Gallatin, Madison, and Yellowstone rivers have drawn fly fishing tourists. The Paradise Valley has attracted Hollywood royalty, and the foothills of the Rockies have become dotted with vacation homes of Angelenos. Early settlers in this migration, like Peter Fonda and Ted Turner, seem almost like natives now. High fashion may belong to the East and West coasts, but as for outdoor chic, what's cool in mountain bikes, running shoes, and river sandals, Bozeman is at the forefront. It is not a city where you end up by chance. It is a destination. You can't blame the new Montanans for coming here. They are drawn by the rivers and the mountains, the big sky east of the Rockies, and the rich fir forests west of the Rockies, and the fishing. From a paleontologist's point of view, the resulting change is something like deposition. Geological environments are of two sorts, depositional and erosional. At the extremes, a river delta deposits a lot of silt and builds up the land, while a mountain slope is constantly eroded by wind and rain. All of history is depositional, I suppose, in the sense that events accumulate, languages and cultures change, adding layer upon layer of human experience. In Bozeman, the rate of cultural deposition is high and increasing. Espresso is now the drink of contemporary Montana. I'll wager that it's easier to get a triple skim latte around Bozeman than it is on the Upper West Side of Manhattan, at least if you don't want to get out of your vehicle. We have drive-up espresso stands where the pickups and the Priuses idle in line together. Latte is the cowboy coffee of the 21st century. Bozeman is just east of the Rockies, in the foothills of the mountains. To the south lie the deep, fir-banked canyons of the Gallatin River and the bison and elk of Yellowstone National Park. To the west is farmland cut by the Madison River. In July, the river is filled with small drift boats, skippered by fishing guides, often college-educated Northeasterners who practice the religion and business of trout in Montana in the summer and Argentina in the winter. To the northwest lies the Blackfeet Reservation, and beyond that, Glacier National Park with its Going to the Sun Highway that takes you over the Continental Divide. To the northeast lies the High Line, the towns that dot the rail line just beneath the Canadian border, towns like Cutbank and Shelby, where I grew up. All of these routes have their attractions, but for time travel, I recommend driving due east. Take Route 90, a modern four-lane highway that parallels the Yellowstone River, which itself was a highway of sorts in earlier times. The 21st century keeps you in its grip for a good 150 miles until you leave the highway at Billings, the state's largest city with a population of about 90,000. Take Route 87 north, a flat two-lane road through farm and rangeland that leads to a crossroads marked by an enormous truck stop on the southeast corner. Look east down Route 200 to the heat-rippled horizon. That's where the past lies. The next town is Winnett. It is small, population 175, hidden from the road, and deep enough into the all-but-empty western end of the Great Plains that there are no familiar fast food chains. There are, however, satellite dishes everywhere. And on the way into town a few years ago, you could see small roadside signs made as part of a high school anti-drug campaign. Unhappy reminders of modern life on the wide-open, economically depressed high plains. Violets are blue. Roses are red. If you try meth, you'll be dead. The gap between Bozeman's prosperity and the economic situation of eastern Montana is significant. The state as a whole had more than 14% of the population under the poverty line in the 2000 census, which partly indicates the dire situation of the several large Indian reservations in the state. In Gallatin County, which includes Bozeman, the rate was 12.8%. In Garfield County, which does not include any reservation, it was 21.5%. From Winnett east, the road runs through open country for the next 75 miles. There are no towns. Other cars and trucks are few. The power lines are not always visible. The road runs straight to the horizon. Even traveling at 80 miles an hour, you can feel the distance and the emptiness. In a car with a tank full of gas, it is exhilarating. On foot, it can be oppressive. If the space seems endless now, what did it seem 200 or 100 years ago? The road cuts through the Missouri Breaks, the same eroding badlands that Lewis and Clark passed through, that Sitting Bull knew, that were here when humans came across to North America from Asia and began to hunt mastodons. Well, almost the same. The short grass prairie has changed. Sagebrush, a staple of old Western movies, is everywhere, the result of overgrazing by cattle and sheep as far back as the early 1900s. When the buffalo lived on the plains in the millions, the land was still dry and sparsely vegetated. But the short grass dominated. The land was always harsh and never drew agricultural settlements of Indians. It did support abundant wildlife, although the buffalo were not here in their millions when the first humans hunted here. One school of thought is that the buffalo and the Great Plains evolved along with the first Americans as they burned the prairie to keep it open. The Mussel Shell River marks your passage into Garfield County, and you begin to see exposed rocks, many around 65 million years old. You now occupy several slices of time. You are in the present, driving back to what feels like the early 20th century or the 18th or 17th. But all around you, the torn earth reveals the deep past, open for investigation. The rocks of what geologists call the Hell Creek Formation are what you see from the road. The formation was named in 1907 by Barnum Brown, a paleontologist from the American Museum of Natural History, based on rock layers near Hell Creek. It is a mixture of sandstone and siltstone that is exposed in Montana, Wyoming, and North and South Dakota. The rock beds that make up the formation vary in thickness or depth, from 170 meters in Garfield County, where Barnum Brown first identified it, to 40 meters in Macomb County, Montana. The formation preserves somewhere between 1.3 and 2.5 million years, depending on different interpretations. These are not just any million or so years. These rock beds are made of sediment deposited at the end of the age of dinosaurs. The Hell Creek Formation is probably the best record anywhere on Earth of terrestrial life at the end of the Cretaceous era, 210 million years ago to 65 million years ago, just before and right at the mass extinction that wiped out about 35% of all species, including the dinosaurs. The end of the Cretaceous era is marked in much of Garfield County at the top of the Hell Creek Formation by a dark line in paler rock. The line is coal deposited just after the mass extinction that marks the beginning of part of the Fort Union Formation. This, at least, is a rule of thumb. Elsewhere in the world, chemical markers give a very specific and clear way to mark the end of the Cretaceous. But in eastern Montana, these chemical markers are sometimes present, but not always present. So the process of refining the date at which the Cretaceous ended and the mass extinction occurred continues. Nonetheless, the dark line called the Z-coal by some researchers is a stark reminder of the vertical progress of deep time. The abstract numbers in the millions may be hard to comprehend, but the rock, in varying color, marking the agonizingly slow accumulation of silt from overflowing streams, sand from beaches, or rotting plants transformed to coal, is there to see and touch. The formation is rich with evidence of ancient life.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.